So after the first property, I managed it for 1 year. Learned a lot about when it came to finding tenants, managing tenants. And then you learn a lot about the property, what to look for, how these tenants live in the property. Right? It wasn't the perfect duplex. Pretty much a single family separated into two apartments. Right? One hydrometer, one gas meter, one furnace, one water tank. But two separate entrances. Right? Main floor is one apartment, second floor is another apartment. So, you know, and for me, I was the one who really managed that property in the first year, right? Dealing with the tenants. And then trying all of these things that I read in the books, you know, how to make the tenant happy, keep the tenant happy, right? And when it came to any little repairs and maintenance, any little problems, which you probably experienced, right? Living in a student rental, you know, for me, it was always having that problem solving way of thinking, right? Such that when I solve the problem, the next time it comes around, I know exactly what to do. And so all of that experience in the first year, right? That I didn't know, but it was a stepping stone in what to look for when you're finding the next property. The second property. Okay. So at the end of the first year, right, remember that I told you I had no real estate background in my family. So that was half the mental battle because they never believed they could own more than one property in their lifetime. I proved them wrong. I proved them that yes, there is a way, it's possible. So this is where that intangible, you really have to believe and stick to what it is you're doing. If you're getting into the real estate business now, you're a month in the game, really, you know, have to stick to what it is you're doing. And then when everyone is saying, you know, if you're doing this, sounds so easy, everyone can do it and everyone can become rich. I never said that. But it was really a mental battle. So if you have real estate background in your family, that's a positive, okay? If you don't, then just, you know, keep going back to the box and follow those people, okay? As your mentors or your heroes or whatnot, okay? So then at the end of the first year, when my parents were seeing how I was making money in real estate, and I said, oh yeah, the property was positive cash flow, 400, right? So give or take, because rents were all inclusive, okay? And then of course, later down the road, you'll see my whole portfolio, 7 duplexes, the second, the third, everyone, the next one is better than the one before, right? You know, so you evolve and your knowledge experiences, it accumulates, right? So then, at the end of that first year, parents said, they were telling my older brothers, right, both of them my employees, that they don't think they could ever retire. And, you know, and for me, right, that was very concerning because pretty much my parents and probably your parents around the same age, they're in that same boat as baby boomers, which they're getting close to retirement. And, you know, they don't think they could ever retire. They don't have a retirement plan. When they reach age 65, they get the surprise that, you know, the pensions aren't paying enough, or they have to go back and work a job. It's very unfortunate, okay? You can't work your whole life till 65, and then you got to still keep working. Although the government have bumped the retirement age to 67, so they wouldn't have to pay up too early. But 6 years, right, as I mentioned before, there was a lot of trouble adapting to this country, right? So I really felt like a minority, like an immigrant, coming into this country, right? And I didn't, you know, couldn't speak that well, right? Which is why I made that commitment to develop my communication skills, doing Toastmasters, doing public speaking, right? So then, you know, we decided to try a rental property on their own, right? Spent 6 months looking for a property. Now, when I started off, I relied on a real estate agent, which is probably what, you know, you guys did. But then you realize you're not so smart. You know, you can do better. So that's what I did starting off in year number one. And for 6 months when I was dealing with an agent, they were not, you know, they were not working around the clock. Some would work either Saturday or Sunday, you know, some doesn't work after 5 p.m. You know, come on. You know, if you're self-employed and you wanna survive in the business, it's 24/7/365. Sleep and breathe the business. Regardless if you have family or children, right? That's what you gotta do if you want to be really successful. Some of the most successful agents, mortgage brokers, right? You are doing deals 2-3 in the morning. 2-3 in the morning, right? Even if you have kids, my mortgage broker has kids, right? I call her 2-3 in the morning, right? Or she will call me, right? Because we have to underwrite the deal within 24 hours. That's what it takes to become very successful, right? So the agents who I was dealing with, you know, in year number one in Hamilton, right, I tell you, I look at them now, right, I mean, they're doing okay, right, but, you know, when you are advising people how to make money, advising them what to do, which property to buy, you know, you have to really be in the client's best interest and really make them money. Not just try to get a commission from them, right? You have to really focus on making the client the most money possible, okay? So aside from that, right, what I realized, this was in 2014, okay? I was pretty much driving up and down different streets, talking to neighbors. That was a different way of finding things. If you are just looking on MLS, you're limiting yourself to finding deals. You have to go talk to people. There's deals in the private market. It wouldn't be on the MLS, right? But you might see a for sale sign, right? Or someone might put a sign up on a property saying for sale, the owner. That's how I ended up getting the second duplex in Hamilton. And it was only $150,000, right? So the reason why $150,000, because my family, right, this is a lot of risk for them. A lot of risk. $150,000, I look at it now, that's a baby, right? Compared to $1.5 million. Okay? So, but to my surprise, the private deal was again driving up and down different streets. Now, my mindset at that point in time was, right, my dream was in 2017 or 18, which is a goal that I wrote down, to own 2 positive cash flowing investment properties, right? That was my dream. Now I own 7, right? But that was my dream. So the second one, that was already a dream come true. It was a private for sale sign, duplex for sale, and I called the number. The next day I went and I saw it, right? And it was a old woman having triple bypass surgery, and you know, she got tired and she wanted to sell it. When I went and looked at the property, you know, I found there was 2 separate hydrometers, which I saw from the outside. That's all I knew. And then when I went on the inside, right, you had 2 separate furnaces, two separate water tanks, two separate entrances. It was a legal duplex, $450,000, right? Today is $450,000, right? So the mindset at that point in time, right? I didn't know it would be $450,000 today, but the mindset at that point in time was, I have to choose the specific areas in downtown Hamilton, right? Where over the next 5 years, one, I would recoup 100% of the capital that I invested, right? And then the second thing is, right, that the property will double and triple in value. The reason why is because equity is what makes you become wealthy, right? When I started off, very little money, I didn't have $1 million or $2 million. I had to create it. $1 million, $2 million now it's good, but at that point in time, right, $150,000 buying a property, that amount was a lot of money, right? The reason why I spoke about buying the first property, the second property, right, and really making sure that it's all set up the right way, because each property is a stepping stone. Meaning that when property is fully rented, that total rental income now becomes added to your job income, and it boosts, right, your income debt ratio, right? So now you're more creditworthy, more qualifiable for a mortgage, right, when you're getting the next property, right? So from the second one, right, it was, so then the third one, part of getting the third property was part, yes, family money, but then it was also my money as well, right? Because at that year, I got my real estate license as well, right? So yes, there's the benefit, get the commission by getting a deal, you know, close a deal, you can also roll that into the property, okay? Right, towards down payment, closing costs, etc. And then from there, right, the same strategy, right, the way my mind was thinking was buy one income property every year. And then a lot of people were thinking, okay, well, Chin, how could you keep getting third mortgage, fourth mortgage, fifth mortgage? Right? You have to become very creative when it comes to the financing, right? So like yourself, right, you got a group of people, hopefully all of you are working a job, right? You know, and great, because all of you as a group are thinking the same way, right? That's good, I didn't have that. So for me, it was just me alone, my books, and then that, it was only until the end of 3, 4, 5, that's when I started attracting people who were also in the same real estate business, right, and were also thinking the same way, and then I had more friends. So, you know, it didn't feel too, you know, like, hey, I'm crazy. Now, just to backtrack, in year number 3, right, remember when I said in year number 1 there was an Indian guy I met in the real estate investment course who was doing rent-to-own. That guy actually introduced me to a Vietnam person who was investing in Toronto, and he already had 12 properties in High Park. Each of them today is 1.2 million, okay? So that person, you know, in year number 3, so in 2014, I called the person, right, and I was scared. I was working in the bank, okay, at that time, working, saving money, and then managing the first rental property. And that day, I remember, it was a Tuesday, I had to go to work in the bank for 2 p.m., and then I called him in the morning, 11 in the morning, right, and I didn't know, I was so nervous, left the voicemail, and then after, at 12, he returned my call and said, meet him at a Starbucks in Toronto, okay? And then everything inside me felt like, I'm not gonna work. I'm gonna go meet this person. Have you ever done that before? Something so stupid? Right? You have to go to work. You have a boss. You have no reason. And then you just say, F this. I'm not going to the back to work. And then I went to meet this person. That day was a life changer for me. Do you know why? Because I spent 4 hours speaking with that person. And now today I'm also good friends, very good friends with that person. Every month or every other month I'll go meet and have coffee with him. Right? And that person is not public. He's a very private person. Right? That 4 hours opened up everything for me. So you know like how Warren Buffett, he read all the books in the library from age 12 to age 19, 20. And then after when he discovered Intelligent Investor, the book from Graham, what's his name?
Benjamin Graham.
And then that was the, it just opened up everything for him. The whole buying more philosophy, it just, you know, you're not investing in like buying a stock, you're investing in businesses, you're owning a piece of that business, right? That's what happened to me that day, 4 hours. When I had coffee with that person. And that's where I got more creative with the finance. Meaning, it's not only the six banks that exist in this world, okay? BMO, TD, RBC, Scotia, CIBC. You have B lenders, you have private lenders, right? But don't go to the private lenders, they'll kill you. They have you by the neck and they charge you 10 to 12%. Right? That's dangerous and it's expensive money. If you don't know what it is you're doing. But you have B lenders. They don't care about your income. Right? They don't care about your credit score. Right? If you have a portfolio, property number 1, 2, 3, you get what I'm saying, right? And it's all done properly. Cash flowing, good income, good property, good location, right? You have collateral, right? Now you can borrow money. That's how I got the 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th.
You're saying like you have four properties, that's what you're able to borrow from the equity from those properties?
Absolutely, right? So buying duplexes, $167,000, $150,000, right? And then now it's $450,000, right? Now you can refinance, right? But you have to keep the job, okay? Keep the job. Still have the income. The bank loves income, right? So you can qualify for the mortgage. That's how I bought out that Filipino guy December last year, right? That was a 12-month inflow process. But thank God I got rid of that guy. He was, you know, a waste of time. But I was able to qualify for mortgage with Scotiabank myself. How is that possible? Self-employed, right? And I was able to qualify for mortgage for $320,000 with Scotiabank. Right? How is that possible? He didn't think it was possible. And then when I showed him, right, that you think I can't qualify for a mortgage myself because I'm self-employed with Scotiabank, and I did it. And then I bought him out. It was the best feeling ever. But what I'm trying to say is you gotta be making income. Right? So every year, fortunately that year, every month from March to November 30th, I believe, that year, last year, every month I was closing the deal. Okay, closing the deal. That's my doing deals. Okay. You have to love something in the business, right? So that's a whole different talk. How you get the deals, and what I realized from the past 6-7 years, when I started off taking that investment course. Right, which was, you know, just to give me more, I would say, say, more of a solid foundation. But what really created that bedrock and all of the principles that I have developed today was really the experience. You really learn a lot more from experience. Right? I'm really surprised that real killers and real deal makers don't really talk about how you really